All right, so now recording. My name is Jane Maganot. I work with the University of Arkansas System, Division of Agriculture, Cooperative Extension Service. And we work with the local cities on doing stormwater education through a program called the Northwest Arkansas Urban Stormwater Education Program. We'll talk about this in a little bit, but first I wanted to introduce a few people that are gonna be a part of this presentation. And to make sure everybody's in the right place, this is the Stormwater 101 Bentonville presentation. I want to introduce Trish Way. She's the other person that will be on camera today. She is going to be helping me moderate the chat and make sure that any questions that you may have can get answered and addressed. And we will be holding questions till the end, but please go ahead and put your questions into the chat as they arise. And so Trish also works with the Stormwater Education Program with the University of Arkansas. I also want to introduce Janet Paith. Her camera is not working today, but she is available for questions, and she is the Stormwater Coordinator for the City of Bentonville. And so she'll be here to help us with any technical questions that come up that are specific to the City of Bentonville. Also would like to introduce Jeff Roberts. He is a stormwater inspector with the City of Bentonville. So he's the boots on the ground guy that goes out and does our inspections. And Dan Weiss is the city engineer for the City of Bentonville. So they are here as kind of technical people to help us answer any questions that are specific to Bentonville that might come up. And then also just to give some little backdrop into this presentation, I'm gonna go ahead and screen share so you guys can be oriented here. Is that correct, Trish? Thumbs up, okay, thank you. So this is, this presentation series came about with the floods that happened in late April of this past year. I was on social media and there was quite a few stormwater questions that pop up as they do when stormwater happens. They tend to go away when the stormwater recedes, but while the stormwater is high, questions started popping up and I started seeing answers and some not really, I don't want to call it misinformation, but just not quite correct information that was being put out about stormwater regulations and what the cities have control over or what the cities don't have control over. And I thought, you know, this is just some basic stuff that maybe we can kind of clear up the muddy water a little bit and try to set some of the records straight. So I contacted kind of the large four big cities in our area, which is Bentonville, Springdale, Rogers, and Fayetteville, and asked them if they would be willing to help me put together this presentation, or at least oversee the presentation, that would kind of show the rules and regs of those specific cities. And they were eager to do so. And so we're gonna keep this pretty surface level and pretty basic. We're gonna start at the federal regs, work our way through the state regs and down to the municipal regs. This is something that we could really get deep into the weeds pretty quickly, and maybe we'll do a Stormwater 201 down the road, but for right now, we're gonna keep it pretty basic and introductory level. What this presentation is not gonna do is look at individual drainage issues or individual property issues that you might be having in the city. If it's something that you think that is citywide, please feel free to comment. And if not, if you do comment, and we might just tell you, this is something that we think should be answered on an individual basis, and we'll reach out to you individually or have you reach out to us individually. And this presentation is really centered around water quality and stormwater pollution prevention. So how do we protect water quality through prevention of pollution getting into our stormwater? Throughout this presentation, I'm going to be hopping in and out of the presentation quite a bit, showing you resources. My goal is to be able to get you to the resources that you can, so you can find the information that you need if you have questions about stormwater. And so I'm going to be hopping in and out of websites a lot. Don't feel like you need to write down all the websites, because we're going to give you a resource sheet at the end that has all the links listed out. If you're watching the recording of this and you got the link somehow and you don't have access to that resource sheet, it's not in the email, and whatever, just my email's at the end of this presentation. And you can email me directly. Just let me know which city that you're watching, so you get the correct resource sheet for that city, because they're very city specific. All right, so let's get started. So this is the Cuyahoga River. This was 1969. It was a river that caught fire. This was what was the initiator of the Clean Water Act, and what was the creator of federal regulations. This is Ben. He was the utilities director of Cleveland back in 1969. And he was saying that we just dumped all of our waste right into the river without thinking about it. I used to say things such as the solution to pollution is dilution. And then when that pollution discharge was leaving our factories and going into the river, it appeared like it was going away. So it was out of sight, out of mind. Well, until it caught fire, and then it was back. It was very much in sight. It actually burned 12 times, it being the river, burned 12 times. It cost millions of dollars, and actually people lost their lives. So this was a very serious health and human safety concern for our waterways. And so because of that, the feds stepped in and Congress created the Clean Water Act. It was first established in 72 and then has had some addendums since, a major one in 77. And it gave the EPA the authority to implement pollution control and to establish the basic structure of regulating discharges into our pollutants. I've used that term discharges now twice. So a discharge is where our water is leaving an entity and going into a water body. So think about a pipe leaving a factory or a ditch line that is a culvert going into a creek or stream. And so this is actually the first time we've looked into this term called a non-point source pollution as well. And I'll define that now. So the point source pollutions are things like factories that have a pipe that comes out of them and deposits or discharges directly into a creek or stream or water body. So think about a factory, or perhaps this example gives a shipping vessel. If there was a pollutant in the waterway, you could tell exactly where that pollutant was coming from. It's not going to take much to, usually it's a visual or some kind of, maybe it might be a fish kill. You can follow that pollution source, that pollution all the way back to its source. So it's a point source. You can point to it. A non-point source pollution is a little bit harder to identify because it's coming from many different places. So we have things like our roads and our city streets, our construction sites, farms. Think about if you're swimming out in Beaver Lake and you see a piece of trash, you don't know where that came from. It could have come from the back of a pickup truck that was going down the highway. It could have come from somebody recreating there at Prairie Creek. It could have come from many different places. We don't know exactly where that came from. And that's the way non-point source happens. If there's, you know, an oil in the water, we don't know exactly where that oil source came from. So we can't point to the source, and it makes it a little bit harder to regulate. So this is, the rest of this presentation is really going to dive into how to try to do this. So let's just talk a little bit first. Let's back it up and talk about what is stormwater. So stormwater is anything that runs across our surface during a rain or snow melt event. So when it rains on a typical, average, non-developed landscape, I shouldn't say typical or average, I'll just say non-developed landscape, is that about half of the water is going to soak into the ground and about 10% is going to run across our surface. This is a natural landscape. It's got some development on there. There's some houses, there's some roads. But if it rains in this, about half of it's going to soak into the ground. As we start to develop, we're going to start creating more and more impervious surfaces. Impervious. So that means a hardscape. Think about our driveways, our roads, our rooftops, our sidewalks, parking lots, anything that creates a hardscape where water cannot go through. That's an impervious surface. So as we start to build, we're going to start letting, there's less opportunity for rain to soak into the ground, and it's going to start creating more and more runoff. So this is the city of Bentonville. This is kind of a north looking south, south shot. And so up in, you'll see there's quite a bit of impervious surfaces. So check out those hardscapes that are not allowing water to discharge. There's even some being built, and there's some being protected, some green spaces being protected in this shot. Bentonville, I do not have to tell you, is a landscape that is changing quite frequently. So as we get to an urban landscape and we start going to about a 75% build out, so we have about a 75% impervious surface. What used to be 50% soaking into the ground is now 15%. So that's a huge jump. So we're not getting as much groundwater infiltration, but we're getting a lot of runoff. So what was 10% is now 55%. So that's creating a large volume at a larger velocity. So water is moving at a higher speed coming off of our streets. And so this is an area that has quite a bit of green space. But if we take out all the impervious surfaces, all the sidewalks, the driveways, parking lots, buildings, and roads, it's actually about a 50% build out here. So that's quite a bit of a runoff being generated. So we need to get that water off of our streets. So we have what is called a municipal separate storm sewer system. Some of our older cities, think about New York City, Chicago, that older development, even parts of old St. Louis, those are in a combined sewer system. And so when it rains, the storm water goes into the same set of pipes that go to the wastewater treatment plant that get treated, which you're like, oh, that's great. It's cleaning everything off of our streets. But the problem is that when they get a lot of rainfall, those are very apt to back up. And then you have sewage backing up into our streets, which is a health and human safety concern. And so we needed to get stormwater off of our streets. We don't want to put it into the combined sewer system. So let's put it into a municipal separate storm sewer system. All of the drainage here in Northwest Arkansas, we have no combines here. So this is all of our systems, and it's made to get the water away from our homes and our streets to get them safe from flooding. And so we can get emergency vehicles down during a rain event and you're able to get home safely. And so that's what they're designed to do, which is to get the water away from our streets as fast as possible into a creek. And this is a very simple technique. So if you follow it, if you go to a storm drain inlet, you can walk and eventually you're going to find an outfall where that water is leaving the storm drain system and going into a creek or stream somewhere, possibly a lake. Sometimes it goes into a detention or retention pond first, and we'll talk about that here in just a little bit. But eventually it's going to hit up into our surface waters. So what could be in our stormwater that is considered pollution? I mean, it's rainfall, it's natural. Why is that bad? Well, we have things like sediment, nutrients, bacteria, pesticides, automobile fluids. I believe there's 298,000 registered vehicles inside of Benton County. So think of like 2 or 3% of those had an oil leak. That's almost 3,000 cars leaking oil into our waterways. And litter. So those are all things that can get into our waterways just from our streets and creeks, or from our streets and sidewalks into our creeks. All right. So now we're going to get into the regulations a little bit. So we talked about what stormwater is, the potential pollutants that can come from it. So let's talk about how we're going to address these non-point source pollution. So we talked about the Clean Water Act a little bit. That actually created the Environmental Protection Agency, or the EPA. So that's still at a federal set. They came up with a code of federal regulations that created the, so stay with me here, National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, NPDES, National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System. Easy for me to say. So, and that's, it does what it's supposed to do. It says it's to eliminate pollution discharges, and that's its goal, and that's what it's made to do. And the way that we work here in Arkansas is that those permits are set, the permit requirements are set at the federal level. The state has to come up with how they're going to address those requirements, and they're supposed to be the ones that have the oversight of the requirements. And then they have to give down to the city level, how are you going to meet these permit requirements? What are you going to do that's going to hit these requirements that have been put upon you? This is an unfunded federal mandate. So they are not given money when it comes with these mandates. They're just told you must do it. So an NPDES permit, there are three that are issued from the state of Arkansas. And so they are construction, industrial, and municipal separate storm sewer system. I'm gonna touch on the first two lightly, and then we're gonna dive into that third one, that municipal separate storm sewer system permit. All right, so construction sites. This is, again, we're gonna look at this start first as a state level. This isn't our city requirements. This is what's required at the state of Arkansas. And for anything larger than 1 acre of land, they are smaller plots that are part of a common plan. So think about like a subdivision of a developer's coming through, and even though he's putting in individual lots of homes, it might be a quarter of an acre. The permit is required for anything that disturbs an acre or more as a common plan. So that's one main subdivision. They do have to have they do have to file for a construction permit with the state. If it's less than 5 acres, they don't have to have the permit on file with the state, but they must have it on site and available in case of an inspection. But the if you're greater than 5 acres, you have to have it approved through the state of Arkansas. And so what does that mean? What's required? So there's a Stormwater Pollution Prevention Plan, or SWPPP. And those are the framework, the base of their construction site that shows how they're going to manage and mitigate stormwater from leaving that site. And so there's another acronym for you. We love our acronyms. So best management practices. So that's a site map that shows where they're going to put in all the things, such as like a silt fence that might go around the perimeter of anything that might be land disturbance. It's going to show how their plan of when they're going to put down grass seeding to make sure that there's any exposed soil that has to be covered, so it grows, like say with an annual rye, very quickly, so the soil the next time it rains doesn't wash away. It might be storm drain inlet protection, like a boom or a wattle in front of that storm drain to keep anything from going inside of that. It's a living document. It's made to be changed. So if something changes on the construction site, anybody who's done construction knows that things don't go as planned. So it needs to be changed and addressed. So if we end up not putting in an inlet here, we end up putting it here. It's a change document. It has to be updated regularly. And it also has to be inspected by a construction personnel from their company. And so that is done, if they have a choice, they can do it every week, or they can do it every 2 weeks and after a quarter inch rain. And they have to have an inspection form. They fill it out. It shows they've checked all their BMPs after a rain or once a week. And they put that into a mailbox. You guys have seen these before on the at a construction site. Inside that mailbox is their stormwater pollution prevention plan, as well as any inspections that have been done on that site. And that rain gauge is there because if they're doing the quarter inch rainfall, they need to measure every time they go to that site and they do their inspections, they monitor how much rain is coming in. So, okay, we have a lot of construction that's happening that's a lot less than 1 acre. They don't require a state permit. However, there are some regulations that will come into play on the local level, on those city ordinances, and we'll get to those in just a little bit. For the permit, the industrial permit, I'm not going to go into detail with this. There aren't that many permits in the city of Bentonville, actually very, very few industrial permits in the city of Bentonville. So this isn't a major concern for the city. This is usually a lot more in the outer areas of the state. So we're not going to go into that other than they are required to do water quality sampling, and they also must submit annual reports to the state, and they are inspected. If you do have questions with these, this is our first, I'm going to pop this out here. So this is our DEQ, so the Arkansas Department of Environmental Quality. This is their land page for water quality and NPDES permits. And so if you are wanting to know what a permit is, what it says, and what's required of it, this is the page. So here are three main permits. Construction stormwater permits. So these are the constructions. This is greater than 5 acres. This is their permit requirements. This shows you where the requirements are. And this is showing what required documentation they have to submit. This is the smaller. So this is the 1 to 5 acres. This is their permit. And this is the required documents that they must submit. Industrial. So here's the industrial permit and their required documents. And this is called a non-exposure permit. It's a certification on top of that permit. And actually just, it's mostly for when there's just a roof covering that might protect some of the main infrastructures happening, but they still have the potential to have a pollutant discharge. So they have to fill out that. And then here is the municipal storm sewer system. So this is where you would find their permit. And if you notice, they have an effective date on them. The construction one actually is newly renewed this year. They're a 5-year permit. So these last for 5 years, and then the state has to relook at that permit, see what corrections need to be made, what updates need to happen, and then they'll reissue that permit. They all go into public comments. You guys can read them, look at them, make your comments. Like, I think this needs to be stronger. I think this is overstep, and get those comments in, and then you can do those comments and address them with the permits. All right, so let's get into the MS4 permit. So this is where I get excited. This is my stuff. So the municipal stuff. So we have our general permit that was first initiated in 1990 as a phase 1 permit. This hit our medium and large scale urban areas which is a population of 100,000 or more. And the state of Arkansas, it only affected the city of Little Rock. No other city fell under that regulation. But as we start ratcheting down in 2003, the phase two regulations came into play. And those are for anything that's a population of 10,000 or more, or an urbanized area. So an urbanized area is a little bit, hold on a second, my screens are messed up here. There we go. An urbanized area is anything that has this kind of algorithm of a population density of greater than 1,000 residents per square mile, or they share a common infrastructure. If you look at the urbanized areas of Northwest Arkansas, so here we are, it goes from Bella Vista all the way down to Greenland and hits kind of the east and west sides of our cities. Some of these areas you might consider pretty rural. However, they do fall in an urbanized area due to that 1,000 or more residents, or they're at least touching I-49. It's a common infrastructure that runs through. There's also a couple of oddball jurisdictions in Northwest Arkansas, such as the University of Arkansas has their own MS4 jurisdiction. All right, so the EPA guidelines. So this is what the permits. So we have the Clean Water Act. They're telling the state of Arkansas that you must hit these 6 minimum control measures within your jurisdictions of your state. They are public education and outreach, public involvement and participation, illicit discharge detection and elimination, construction site runoff, post-construction runoff, and pollution prevention and good housekeeping. So we're going to look at Bentonville and how they say they're going to address those 6 measures. So the state of Arkansas says, okay, this is what the feds say we're going to require. We've written a permit that says this is how we think our city should be able to do this. And then the city of Bentonville has to write a plan or a stormwater management plan, a SWMP, or we call it a SWMP. What our management plan is back to the state. This is what our regulations we're going to put into place to make sure we can hit those guideline requirements. So every 5 years that permit comes up, they write their plan. The state performs an inspection of that permit for every permit term. So every 5 years, the state comes in and does an inspection of their management plan to make sure they're doing what they say they're going to be doing. And they also have to give their plan teeth. They can't just say we're going to do this and then not do it. So they actually create some kind of standards or ordinance. And so in the city of Bentonville, it's ordinance 2006-167, or just commonly known as the Stormwater Ordinance. Public participation, education, and outreach. I'm going to lump these two together because the city contracts us, the University of Arkansas's Cooperative Extension Service, to do the public education, outreach, and participation requirements. So that's the minimum control measures 1 and 2. And so we do different programs such as storm drain art. You might have seen those. We have a whisker project that we've done throughout Northwest Arkansas where we put blue survey markers at storm drain inlets and take them to their outfall so people can see above ground where that water flows. Our job is to make sure residents and professionals working in that community know that stormwater does not get treated before going to a wastewater treatment plant and what their impacts of stormwater pollution prevention can be. We help organize, city meetings that might happen that are relevant with stormwater. We try to provide, it's one of the greatest things about Extension is we provide research-based unbiased information. So if an ordinance pops up, we're there to show both sides how it might hit you. We do a lot of litter cleanups in the area, a lot of school programs. So Trish is actually going to put the annual report from last year into your chat. So you're welcome to look at that and see what we did in this last year during the times of COVID for public education and outreach. So let's move on. This is back to the city of Bentonville's responsibility of illicit discharge detection and elimination. So that sounds pretty hefty, and it really is. To me, this is what the big bulk of the MS4 program. So an illicit discharge is anything other than stormwater that's going into our creeks and our streams through our storm drain infrastructure. So think about parking lot runoff, discharges from construction sites, discharges from vehicles, inlet dumping, anything that's not stormwater. There are very few allowable discharges. So things like air conditioning condensate, irrigation oversprayed. There is a list of things that are considered okay to be discharged. But for the most part, it's anything other than stormwater. And so what does the city of Bentonville say they're going to do? They actually have a pretty hefty illicit discharge detection and elimination plan. One of the things I think that Bentonville has done really well is they have put together a outfall inventory map. So they have to be able to, if there's an illicit discharge, say there's something white in the water that we have seen, they have a really detailed map that shows them where to find it and where to backtrack it. Because the key with illicit discharge is that you want to be able to know the source of that discharge. And again, we're thinking non-point source. It's not like you can follow it right back to its source. So you kind of, it's a process to kind of become a detective, and you have to figure out where is that coming from. And through a detailed mapping of our drain infrastructure and the drainage areas into that infrastructure, we can try to target and find out where that small pollution load is coming from. And so she did, recently they had 600 ponds that were recently mapped to try to help identify those things. They have 65 low points throughout the city limits that they monitor. Has to be on a 5-year permit term. I think they've already hit their permit regulations for this term, so they'll probably be doing them more than once, which is great. And they will get out there and look at those dry spots and those during dry weather to look at spots to make sure there isn't a discharge happening. We look at them during dry weather because it's hard to tell if there's pollution going in during wet weather when the stormwater is moving that fast. So you go out during dry time, so a dry weather inspection to make sure things aren't discolored, they have a foul odor, if the grass isn't dead when it should be green, or it's not green when it should be dead, because all of those things are going to contribute an illicit discharge or to show us there's an illicit discharge. The city of Bentonville also is really great about training its personnel. So there are three main groups of people that are responsible for finding illicit discharge: stormwater inspector and Janet Paith, who's our stormwater coordinator. So those two kind of together. The next one's going to be city staff. So things about like our engineering department, transportation department, code enforcement, police and fire, anybody who's out, parks and recs, that's out in our city streets and finds something, they need to report it back to the city. And then thirdly are the residents of the city of Bentonville. They're responsible for helping us keep an eye on illicit discharges. I'm going to show you guys how to report that if you see an illicit discharge. So we're looking at things again: foul odor, unpleasant smell, discoloration. Again, grass when there shouldn't be, or grass when there should be. That back and forth. So you have to keep an eye on it. And just so you guys know, I want to give you guys a little fun video. This is from when we were trying to show the flow path of stormwater from an inlet to an outfall. This is Agent Colin Massey did a video project series called Pollution Pathways, and he stuck GoPros down storm drains. And so this is Colin being a pollutant discharge. He's an illicit discharge here because our GoPro got stuck in the storm drain. So he had to go in there after it and fish it out. If you'd like to see any of those pollutant pathway videos, there'll be on that resource sheet that we'll put at the end. So you guys can go check out Collins when our GoPro didn't get stuck and actually shows it. Okay, construction site runoff. This is, again, a big beast for the city of Bentonville. There's a lot of construction happening. So this is where a lot of time and resources are being spent, are on construction site. Inspections and plan approvals. There's a lot that goes in. So if you're wanting to build in the city of Bentonville, what do you have to do? You have to get a grading permit. If it's more than 5 acres, they will take the state permit as a suffice. But if it's less than 5 acres, you need to fill out a grading permit with the city. So there'll be a permit in place. That includes a stormwater pollution prevention plan. It has to be reviewed and accepted through the city. There was a post-construction training on best management practices that the city staff must go through. I am going to also just show you that page. It's actually a program that we put together at the Extension Office. Trish Way and Katie Teague developed this program. Anybody can take it. So if you want to know about construction best management practices, you can hop on here and take it. But it's required if you'd like to build in the city of Bentonville. You must have a card that you get to carry around with you. It's good for 2 years to say that, and you can just click on that and it takes you into a Google Docs, and you can fill out that. Again, that resource will be on the resource sheet at the end. There's a construction site concern response. So if there's a discharge happening from a construction site, or we think there's a stormwater violation happening, there's a response system in place for city staff to come out and take a look at that. they have to, as part of their permit requirements, go out every single month and inspect all the construction sites in that area. So we talked about the construction company are doing their once a week or every other week with a quarter inch rain inspections. So Jeff with the city of Bentonville then has to go out and inspect those inspectors. He has to make sure they're doing their job every month. So he has to go to every construction build in the city of Bentonville every month to make sure they're doing what they said they're supposed to be doing. He goes to that mailbox, he grabs the permits, he takes a look at them, and he walks and makes sure that they're actually in place and that they're following their inspection, not just ticking off, oh yeah, everything looks great. And then if they're not, then he has to do an enforcement. So that could be, it could be a fine. However, usually a stop work order goes a lot further. So once you stop down a construction site and say until all of these best management practices are put back in place in accordance with your stormwater pollution prevention plan that has been approved, you cannot continue construction. Post-construction. So this is what happens after the build site. So this is a plan that has to be reviewed and approved before the construction build of what your drainage is going to be after your construction site. So once everything's done and you've gotten your notice of termination, your construction's built out, what have you done to mitigate the drainage from that site? And so this is a review that has to go through the drainage criteria manual. I haven't done this for the other cities, but I love the way that Bentonville put out their drainage manual. So I'm going to pop out and show you guys that one. So this is their drainage manuals online, and they do a really good job at sectioning it out per topic. So if you want to know, because these drainage manuals are hundreds of pages long, and they're very detailed. So it gets a little overwhelming or daunting when you're trying to find a very specific thing. But if you're looking for a specific issue inside the drainage manual, you can look inside, they have it broken out by sections, and find out what you're looking for. So I like the way that they did that on their website. They have to do post-construction system maintenance inspections compliance. So that means that, so after a build is done, they go out and make sure within a year that anything that's been put in place is still being maintained and maintained. They have to do the final construction inspections to prove that they have, covered what they said they were going to cover. And then they have to, they do a, let's make sure I've got this right. I don't want to get my cities confused here. Yeah, they have an operation and maintenance manual that are requested from the site as well, that lays out a plan of what they're going to maintenance on those post-construction development. And another thing with the city of Bentonville that they have been challenged with are infill, and they're down, especially in the, looking at the downtown area. And so they came up with a way to help trying to mitigate some of the runoff from that, those smaller sites that are being developed. So how to address the runoff that's happening from those small sites, they created a low impact development ordinance. So it's called a runoff mitigation ordinance. The link to that ordinance is going to be in the links page, so you can go take a closer look at that. But basically what it does is that it asks anything, if you're not going to fall into that drainage criteria manual that's greater than an acre. So if it's less than that, this is a way for you to say you must either route your stormwater to storm drain infrastructure, or you have to mitigate it through some type of low impact development that's designed to slow down and sink in stormwater. Pollution prevention and good housekeeping. So this is now number six, or this is the last minimum control measure. And what this does is actually look back at the city of what they're responsible for their own backyard. So what's happening off of their transportation yard, their parks and recs department. They have to have their own operation and maintenance programs. They have training programs. We do it as part of our memorandum of agreement to do education. We train the city staff. The city of Bentonville a couple of years ago, it was awesome. We got to go out and we actually did a benthic macro invertebrate kick and pick with the staff. So we took all the staff, we took them out to the creeks and streams, and we showed them the bugs and the ecosystem and what the actual impacts of stormwater are. And we had them catch insects and take a look at them and determine a numeric value of water quality for the city. I enjoyed it. I hope they did too. And then we had pollution prevention manuals for the city operations. So they have to have their own SWPPP on site, and they have to follow it and what their BMPs are. So if they're stockpiling materials, they have to make sure that there's fencing around it to make sure that that's not being discharged during a rain event. is just one of the many examples they have to do. And they also do things like street sweeping. So the streets are part of their property. So they have to make sure that there's not stormwater discharging happening. It's impossible to catch every bit of debris off of our streets. So they have to come up with a plan, and they develop, you know, high use areas. Think of all the events that happen in the downtown square, and trying to even mitigate all the spilt ice cream that might happen coming out of Bentonville. So, you know, they go through and they have street cleaning projects. And then there's also, so we talked about feds, state, local. So this could be, you might have a POA or HOA covenant. So this would be like a homeowners association that says you can't have rain barrels at your property because it's a mosquito factor. We don't want mosquito larvae to live in there, or it doesn't match the color codes. If you do, it has to be in these certain codes. If you want to install some type of mitigation practice, such as putting in native plants, you might want to check with your POA or HOA if you have one, to make sure that they allow those type of plantings in your area. And so all of this falls under the Clean Water Act. And if you don't follow it, there are penalties. This is law that can happen. And this is a picture of the Cuyahoga River today. These plans are working. This is a fishable river. Not only it's a fishable, you could eat the fish that come out of this. This is 2019. The EPA said it was fine to eat the fish that came out of that river now. So what was once on fire is now a recreation river that's gorgeous. And so these standards that are being put into place are working, as we all work very hard to try to match these. And ultimately, our goal is to try to raise awareness and increase water quality. And reduce the financial cost for remediation, because when pollution happens, it can be very expensive to try to remediate those after it happens. So we're trying to hit them before. Okay, again, all these resources will be shared in a document with you, but I do want to pop out to a few of these and show you what they look like and how to find the information you need to find on these pages, because sometimes they're not so intuitive. Bentonville's pretty good, but we're going to look at some other ones too. So here is the stormwater page for the city of Bentonville. They have their annual report right there for you if you want to take a look at what they did this last year and what their requirements are. They have their goals for their stormwater ordinance there. They define some things. They have a lot of resources. So we talked about that runoff mitigation. There's the link to that. Here's a worksheet to try to figure out what your flows are. If you're going to be doing construction, you'll have to determine what your flow is to be able to know what your mitigation is. They have a best management practice manual for construction sites. It's right there. Their ordinance, if you want to check out their ordinance, you hop right there and you can read their ordinance. And so I wanted to also point out Janet's contact information on this as well. So that's her email and her phone number. So Janet, again, is the stormwater coordinator with the city of Bentonville, and your contact for stormwater issues. Another page I wanted to bring up was the 311 page. So if you have a complaint in the city of Bentonville, not just stormwater, but if you have a concern, I should say concern, with the city of Bentonville, you should go to the 311 page. This is a really amazing program that Bentonville has. It's unique to them, and it's how to report a service concern. So here I am, I have a concern. I'm gonna hit a report a concern. There are many things you can be concerned about. With stormwater, we're gonna look at just a couple. One of those is gonna be construction site complaints, flooding and drainage. Perhaps there could be too much garbage. If you look at an outfall and see a lot of trash right there, you think maybe somebody's putting too much in there. And then probably street sweeping would be another one that has to do with stormwater. Water quality one's really more about your drinking water quality. So in your homes or businesses, if you have a concern, that's where that would go. Yes, there should be a drainage. Oh, that was fun. Yeah, drainage, flooding, and construction are probably heavy too. So let's just pop on. You are going down the street and you see a lot of mud on the street that's coming out of a construction site. It's called a track out, and you want to report that to the city. This is where you do so. They do ask for you to give them their information because they want to be able to respond back to you. They are very proud of the work that they do and the effort that they put in. And they want to be able to get back to you to know that. So you put that in there, put the location, describe the concern. If you have an image, that usually is very helpful. So please try to get one, submit it there, and then hit the submit button. Okay, so the next one I wanted to point out was just their bond issue. Bentonville did have a bond issue, a drainage bond issue that passed recently. So this is their bond page. And you can look under drainage improvements is the one we're concerned about. So these are all the things that got approved with that bond. And if you live in one of these neighborhoods and would like to know what happened with that bond, you can click on any of these and look at what the plan is, the timeline on that plan. And if you want to know about updated times, you can always contact Janet and say, where are we at on that bond issue? This is my neighborhood and I still want to know what's going on. So. And also, the last of the resources I'd like to point out is their GIS system for storm drainage. So on that same, you can see you can do the 311 system here. But this very first one, I'm not going to click on it because it is a hefty beast of a system. It's going to slow me down, but it's a great GIS map with layers that you can go through and look at the different storm drain infrastructure that's there, as well as some innovative tools and resources that they've recently done. If you have help or need help navigating that, you can also reach out to Janet and she can help you navigate how to go through that master map to find the stormwater information. So just a couple of resources I wanted to point out that were specialized at Bentonville. And then I would like to point out, if you are outside the city of Bentonville, you're traveling around, you see a stormwater violation, I want to make sure you know what to do if it's not in the city of Bentonville. So this is going to bring us into back to our state level. So this is their landing page. This is just the main page for DEQ. The second option is report a complaint. So you click on that. Again, many things you can be concerned about in the state when it comes to environment. And we're going to look at water pollution. And so you put that in there. This can be anonymous. You don't have to leave your information, but they need to know the location. They would like to have a detailed description and any pictures that you may have. Your information's optional. If you want it to be emailed, you can email back a copy of it and then hit submit. It can be done from your phone or from a computer or any tablet. So we want to recognize that water issues can originate from all land use activities, but we ask you guys to consider the environmental consequences of your actions and your daily decisions. This is going to be very brief, but just kind of go over what we consider our top 10 things you can do to prevent stormwater. Never put anything down a storm drain. Pick up after your pets, put them into a proper disposal, such as a trash can, or you can flush down the toilet. Car care matters. Again, we talked about oil leaks from cars. Don't litter, enough said. Sweep it off. So this is about like fertilizers that get onto our sidewalks. If you're overspraying, put them back, make sure it gets swept back into your lawn. We do have soil testing in the state of Arkansas that's free. So if you're gonna apply fertilizer to your lawn, we ask you to have a soil test done and we can tell you exactly how much fertilizer needs your lawn has so you're not overusing. Any extension office can take in those soil samples. Please contact an extension office in Benton County. You can reach out to Trish Way and she'll tell you how to take that soil sample. It's really easy and it's free. So use it, it can save you money. Composting yard waste. I wanted to touch on this very briefly just because this was an issue that came up. This was Rogers after that April flood. They actually had homes flood because a storm drain inlet got clogged because of grass clippings. So this is a storm drain inlet and its outfall. This is actually at a retention pond. And so all that water that hit that grate, got clogged because of those grass clippings and then created a flooding of homes. So it's important to get those grass clippings, either blow them back into your yards, they don't wash away. You can mulch mow or you can compost or bag and take to the city as well. Manage downspouts. So things like gutter systems, make sure your gutter is going where it would be nice to have it away from your driveway where it's not shooting out into our storm drain infrastructure, but put it back into your lawn, or you can put in things such as rain barrels. Washing your car, think about washing your car. If it goes to a car wash, that water goes to a wastewater treatment plant. If you wash your car in your driveway or the street, that water is going to end up right into a creek, which has all the soap and materials off of your car you're trying to get off. And safely manage pests. Make sure that you have you're reading your label accordingly when you're using pesticides. Vegetating your bare spots in your lawn, sediment's a major enemy for water quality in Northwest Arkansas, as well as the whole nation. So if you have bare spots in your lawn, try to get them with some kind of maybe a shade tolerant vegetation usually is an answer. Contact a county extension agent. We can help you find good ground cover solutions. And if you're interested in low impact development, we're actually doing a workshop with Fayetteville Public Library coming up this Saturday. It's going to be a virtual program. And I think the recording will be on their YouTube afterwards, but it's going to be about homeowners, low impact development. Eric Fusler with Ozark Wild Ones and our Ozark Native Plant Society is going to be talking about native plants and rain gardens. And Lee Porter will be talking about Ozark's green roofs and how to put in green roofs. And I'll be talking about what you can do from your homes to mitigate the runoff that's being generated from your property. All right, so now it's time for questions. If you have questions, please put them into the chat now, and Trish will help us with that. I just want to give just a little story. Bentonville was inspected this last year during 2020. So we had the state inspectors come up. They took a look at their management plan. They looked at their municipal facilities. They went and did a construction site inspection. So this is Jeff Roberts. He's here. I don't want to put him on the spot, but he did an amazing job. And Janet and Dan all did an amazing job walking the inspectors through the stormwater management plan. They were really a stellar example to the other municipalities around here about how to document their management plan. What are we doing, laying it out there? And so I just wanted to give them a kind of a shout out as to what a great job they're doing in that management plan. So they're quite a team. Trish, were there any questions out there? Nope. Excellent. Well, that sounds great. If there are questions, please feel free to reach out to us. Again, Trish, if you put that email into the chat that has our evaluation on there as well. So if you guys would please fill out the evaluation. And again, if you're watching the recording of this, go back to your email. There's a link in your email with the evaluation, or if you're watching it and you didn't get any links, please contact me. I would love to hear your feedback about the program. And if you do decide you have a question down the road, here's our contact information. That's mine. And again, that's Janet's numbers up at the top, the 271-3168. So please reach out to us. If you have concerns in the city of Bentonville, 311, it's a great program. So I hope you guys can use it. If there's not any other comments or concerns. All right. Thank you all so much for being here. I appreciate it. There we go.